Everybody, welcome to this episode of What's New at IBM. As always, I'm your host, PJ Haggerty. And today, we are once again talking to Ryan Yackel, who has the very, very distinguished title now of being the only person who have been on the show three times.
Hey, I like that. That's a good title.
Welcome to it. We're changing. That's going to be your official title. We're going to put it on business cards. But today, we're bringing in Ryan to talk about watsonx.data integration. So Ryan, tell us all about it. What's new? What's happening?
Yeah, what's cool is the shirt that I've been wearing, I finally feel like I can give it credence now. I feel like I've been, you know, last time we talked about Astronomer, we talked about Data Band in the past too, but like, yeah, this is an, this is,
I think that means we need more merchandising. We need better t-shirts. I think
I know, right? I have a hoodie too, I feel like, but it's getting hot now. So I was like, I can't wear the hoodie right now. Anyway, I've been washing the shirt too. So people don't freak out. Like yeah, I have yeah. two of these shirts. So
there are times where Ryan and I don't just sit down and record all these at once.
Right.
They happen over time.
So, watsonx.data integration. This is a new product, a part of the data integration family. And it's probably one of the biggest releases we've had in the last, you know, few years in the data integration family here at IBM. And it's all around consolidating all the different tools in your data integration stack into a consolidated control plane. So when we talk about watsonx.data integration, what is it? It is your data integration control plane that spans across all the different data integration styles you may want to use. So traditional batch ETL, ELT, if you're getting into real-time streaming, obviously not a lot of people are doing it now, but it's getting huge popularity, you know, in all the reports you see. More and more people are moving to data streaming, data replication, tying in both structured and unstructured data pipelines and undergirding it with data observability to monitor all of these things in place. And so the big impetus for all of this was when we talked to a lot of customers and a lot of clients, it's basically they're having to choose between, hey, I want a really great user experience for my data engineering team, my data platform team. That's where the low code, no code kind of tools come into play.
Right.
But then they need a lot of capabilities. And so if you're just not, if you're just doing a simple data movement connectors between tools, then maybe the low code solutions are great for you. But when you get into the complexities of an enterprise organization going not just pure cloud or on-prem and getting in a hybrid environment, which IBM does very well, starting to get into, okay, what other integration styles do I need? Do I need to think about streaming in this use case? Do I need to think about ETL versus ELT in this use case? And so that's where we wanted to have a consolidated view of this and say, hey, instead of going and being forced to pick and choose which tool you want to use for each style, let's have you have a control plane where everything comes in this one single interface. So we're not compromising on the user experience and capabilities. We're kind of bringing those two together so that you can have this control plane experience. And we just, you know, launched this, released this at Think. One of my bosses, Scott Brokaw, he's been out there talking to a lot of customers about it. And we're excited to announce it more publicly coming in June this year.
Which is awesome, which is really awesome. I mean, there's a lot of data integration tools, whether they're open source or commercial. Like how do we kind of differentiate? How is this new solution different?
Yeah, so when we think about the, like we talk about three trends that really we're seeing in the market that said, okay, let's think about a new product to bring, because it seems like these three trends are obviously in our customer base, and also we're seeing it in market consolidation with all this stuff. I think you had this big push around the modern data stack, right? Mm-hmm. Which is still a thing. And I think it's just called the data stack now because I think everyone wants to be modern. So it's just like there's the data stack.
Modern is superfluous. We don't want past data stacks anyway.
Yeah, right. And so and there's all these articles about, like, you know, what was really the modern data stack, the thing that we really thought was going to, you know, get us to the promised land and so on. But what the modern data stack did was it produced all these different tools, right? And you had teams constantly switching and choosing these tools depending on which use case they wanted, right? And then you had this plethora of tools. Like, I just got off the call with a customer this past week, and they were saying they had around like 12 plus data integration tools. And they're not a huge customer, but they have around 12 different types of data integration tools. That's a lot. That's a lot of things to use. And so when we think about these three trends we're seeing, is one is the authoring experiences. And so there's some skill shortages and skill variety maybe in the data engineering, in your data engineering skill set you may have had at a company, right? Some data engineering teams may want to do the low code, no code way. Some are heavily invested into like a Python SDK or using Python for their pipelines, right? Some may be having a mixture of those two things. So the first one is we have all these different authoring experiences that, that pinpoint and choose you and tell you which way you need to go based off your skill level. And we wanted to remove that. And so whereas other tools would kind of just say you have to go this route or you have to choose this authoring experience, we don't do that. We have an opening for low code, no code, high code, pure code if you just want to do that, SQL based, and also AI assisted. We have all those authoring entry points for a customer. So that's one. The second one is the full spectrum of capabilities. I mentioned this kind of earlier, but again, if you look at the tools that are out there today, you're going to have people that are looking for a tool for batch, looking for a tool for streaming, looking for a tool for CDC. Maybe they're plugging in an observability tool to monitor all this stuff. Maybe they've got one tool only dedicated for unstructured data. So there's all these kind of things kind of moving around here. We wanted to basically provide that full stack of integration styles along with your authoring experiences. So you can kind of do that. You can pick and choose which we want to do with that as well. And then the last one is this adaptability component. And so we like to say you don't want to have to run a pipeline and then have to change that pipeline constantly based off architecture changes that go on. And so a lot of times we like to say, hey, as soon as you create, we hear this a lot in the space. It's like, as soon as I create a pipeline, I've automatically created technical debt because I have to start maintaining that pipeline. I may have to change the pipeline if we move different architectures. If we're moving to maybe a fully hosted environment, we have to adapt a new way of doing something, like maybe in a hyperscaler that we're, now we're playing on egress costs that we didn't know we didn't have. And so there's all these kind of things that play into the adaptability component. We want to be able to have you to build a pipeline one time, detach the pipeline authoring experience from the runtime execution so you can run the data where it is and not have to incur a bunch of costs related to that. And it adapts to different architecture changes you're going to move down the line. So really those three things, it's the authoring, the number of different integration styles, and then it's the adaptability component that we really are really investing in for this year.
Which is important because like you said, lots of people have, it's almost like there's lots of toys laying around and they have to play with all of them at the same time.
It's like my daughters when we got to clear out all the toys,
Exactly.
It's like, listen, you got all these toys, you want a new toy, you got to get rid of 50 things before this one new toy comes
in. Exactly. Working in technology is a lot like parenting, but that's a what's new episode for another time.
Yeah.
But I think one of the things that we actually do really well here at IBM is we create these ecosystems that allow you to kind of like pick up all the toys. And just like you're saying, like, okay, listen, so I've got 50 toys that are doing observability, but IBM has one that I could actually integrate with all of them. Mm. What are kind of the parts of the IBM ecosystem that watsonx data integration plays into?
Yeah. So, obviously it's watsonx.data, which is the open source lakehouse for your data and AI lifecycle. That's like our big flagship product that we've been really promoting to the market, both at our Think conferences and a lot of our customers. Usually the conversations are, how do I activate my Gen AI journey? Well, it starts with an open data lake foundation, right? That's where it starts, right? And so around the lakehouse, around .data, today I'm talking about .data integration. There's also .data intelligence. So that's where you're governing, you're cataloging, your rules, all the stuff that goes around making sure that data is secure and governed correctly. Integration is, again, what we had talked about, is the movement of the data, transforming that data and getting the data where it needs to go. And so the first thing we do is we integrate to watsonx.data. We integrate to the intelligence component of that as well to catalog the data that's coming in. And then obviously all the third-party connectors that we have already. Like, I think that even our ETL process alone connects to, over 100 different connectors, data sources, the ones everyone knows about, right? Whether it's hyperscalers, whether it's Databricks, Snowflake, on top of the other our IBM technology. So we are truly agnostic when it comes to that point. And then the big thing, I know I mentioned this here and there, but it is a really big component of IBM strategy, is that the hybrid nature of our posture towards both on-prem and in the cloud is a big differentiator for us. And so when we're going into these organizations and we're talking about, where they're at in their journey, whether they have on-prem data or in the cloud, we have a strategy for that, especially around data integration. Whereas most vendors will say, you got to pick and choose. You got to go one way or the other.
You have to plant a flag and decide. I think that realistically speaking, especially if you're a company that's been around, which a lot of enterprise companies have been around for a long time, you do have that mixture of, okay, so some of the data used to be on-prem and we still need that data, but we also more of our more up-to-date information might be in the cloud, but we need these things to interact. And I think we're one of the few organizations to say, we don't care where your data is. We will help you integrate.
Yeah. And one of the big things too, is that I think Arvin, our CEO, mentioned it was like 90 plus organizations today aren't even tapped into their unstructured data. They're tapped into their structured data, but not their unstructured data. So when you think about where unstructured data lives, it's all over the place. And that's really an untapped data source that we can tie into with dot data integration to pull in better accuracy, pull in better decision-making, pull in, you know, just your overall AI posture that going forward is using that unstructured data alongside structured data. That's our path forward for data integration. We don't want to pick one lane or the other. We want to do both.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And let's say people do want to kind of explore this. How do they get started using watsonx.data integration?
Yeah. So go to watsonx, just type in watsonx.data integration. It'll show up, or go to ibm.com. We'll put some links in the YouTube clip as well for
absolutely,
that. But,
absolutely.
You know, we have trials, we have walkthroughs. If you want to start your own journey of just clicking on and going, hey, I want to walk through a streaming workflow or a ETL process or an observability workflow, it's all there. So that's one way to do it. The other way is we have a June 25th webinar coming up at 12 p.m. Eastern. It's going to be me and Scott Brokaw. We're going to be demoing the product in action, and also showcasing a lot of things coming soon later this year. So you'll see live demos, and it'll be a really fun time if you want to come to that webinar as well.
Yeah, and we'll definitely include a link to that. I myself, you know, in preparation for this, kind of did a walkthrough, and I think that it's super straightforward. It's really easy to get into using this, like this platform. It's super intuitive, I think is the word I'm looking for. It's intuitive. It's not, there's not a huge barrier to entry, which is awesome.
Yeah.
What can we expect in the future? Like, I know the webinar is coming out June 25th, but like, what are we looking forward to?
Yeah. So in that webinar too, we're going to be talking about the things we have. There are some things are in tech preview that are going to be coming out very soon after our June release we have coming up, but we're going to be talking about some of the AI assisted workflows we have. So we have an AI assistant workflow built into our data stage workflows right now, where you can literally type in, hey, I want to build a certain pipeline. It'll pull in the data you used in the past. It'll say, does this look correct? Is this the pipeline you want to build? And automatically create that pipeline. You can do a lot more than that, but that's a quick example of just using an AI assistant to help you generate that content. We also have our Python SDK that we're merging. We talked about earlier, these authoring experiences. You want to, you know, do the traditional Canvas, low code, no code, drag and drop, build your thing that way. Great. If you want to merge that with a Python SDK to build stuff out as well, you can do that too. And then the last part is an agentic workflow that we're working on as well.
That's fantastic. That's fantastic. Because everyone loves agents. Agents is where it's at. Ryan, we will definitely check in a couple of months. Everybody, though, should check out the June 25th webinar. Like I said, we'll provide the link in the description so you can check it out. Ryan, as always, thank you so much for joining us on What's New. I'm sure we'll be talking again soon.
Awesome. Thanks, BJ.
All right. Thanks, everybody. And we'll see you next time.